So as I told you this morning, and for those of you watching online and joining us now, it's so great to have you with us. We're starting a new sermon series called Returned and Restored. And this sermon series comes out of the Old Testament book of Zechariah. And so if you have your Bibles and you want to turn with me to Zechariah, how many of you were able to get the pastor's handout this morning? Everybody got one? Good. Because we're going to start right here in the first chapter of Zechariah with some of the first words that Zechariah is recorded as saying to the people of God. And as we look at this first verse, and we think about this first chapter, think about all the things that God has blessed us with, and all the things that he's brought us through, and all the things he's brought the people of God through. What an amazing story the Bible is, with all the things that have happened over the years. And it says in the very first chapter of Zechariah, in verse 3, it says, "Return to me, declares the Lord Almighty, and I will return to you, says the Lord Almighty." In that very first chapter, in verse 3, there's a promise there of what happens when God's people return to him. And so today I want to talk to you about what it means to return. For some of you who have been walking with the Lord for many years, you might say to me, "Well, Pastor Matt, I don't need to return to the Lord because I never left him." And what a wonderful blessing that is to walk with the Lord. But you know, you don't need to stop returning just because you've already been walking with the Lord. Every morning when you get up, you make a decision about how you're going to live, how you're going to think, how you're going to act, how you're going to speak. And every one of those decisions takes intent, it takes intentional living, it takes intentional choices. And we all, no matter what stage or what age we are in our journey or in our life, have to make a decision every day that we're not going to turn away from the Lord, that we're going to walk in the path of righteousness, that we're going to do the things he's called us to do, and we're going to have his blessing over our lives. Some of us may have drifted away from the Lord, even though we've served the Lord for a long time, and somehow in your prayer life and in your devotional life before God, you've maybe just come to a place where you just feel like you're in a desert. You know, sometimes if you walk with the Lord for a long time, you can drift away. And you can get cold in your heart and cold in your spirit. You don't even realize it. It just kind of happens. It's not something you intended to do. It's not something you started out to do. But you just kind of drift. And some of you might feel a little bit of that. You might say, "You know, I remember the time when I walked into church or when I talked about the Lord, there was just something that came over me and I felt his Holy Spirit with me. And, you know, I haven't felt that in a while. I've been struggling, and I need to return to get to that place where I used to be." Some of you have just begun your journey, and you're trying to figure out, and you're excited, and man, you're just full of life, and everything's great, and everything's wonderful. You still need to get up every morning and make that decision. Some of you have maybe just kind of not really made that decision to dive all the way in. You're just not really sure if this is what you want to do, and you know about the truth, but you're just kind of holding yourself back. I want to talk to you about what it means to return to God's presence and live in his presence on a daily basis. If you look at the world around us, if you look at our country and our culture, our community, and even our church, God is calling us. He's calling me. He's put a fire in my spirit to call the church to return to the Lord God Almighty. To be able to come to a place where we can stand in his presence and say, "God, here we are in our brokenness and in our weakness, in our mistakes and in our misunderstandings, and we are here and we're not going to move until we find that blessing, until we find that anointing, until we find that place where we can come before you, Heavenly Father, and be everything you've called us to be. to completely surrender everything we are and say, Heavenly Father, we are so glad that you are our God. And when we return to that, there's a couple things that we need to do. The first thing we need to do is when we stand in God's presence, we need to reach out in faith. And the scripture came to my mind from Philippians chapter 1, verse 6. And as we're returning, and as we're thinking about our faith, Paul says to the church in Philippi, and I say to the church in Vista, and I am certain that God who began the good work within you will continue his work until it is finally finished on the day when Christ Jesus returns. You know, the church needs to be still expecting the return of Jesus. We still need to live every day as if this was the day that Jesus would return. And we need to plan for 1,000 years as if Jesus is going to build his kingdom on this earth for another 1,000 years. But we need to live in that expectation that not only is our faith about what Jesus was, not only is our faith about who Jesus is today, but our faith informs us that at any moment, Jesus could come again. And that he has begun a work within us that is going to continue until the day he returns. When Paul wrote these words, he had the expectation that it was very possible that Jesus would come back again in his lifetime. That was 2,000 years ago, and I don't know how long it'll be before Jesus returns, but I want to live with that expectation in my heart every day. My faith looks up to you, O Lamb of Calvary, and I am expectantly waiting for whatever it is that God wants me to experience. If God wants me to experience that trumpet blowing, whew, won't that be wonderful? If God wants me to experience my last days on earth as I say goodbye to my family from a hospital bed, then so be it. But whatever God may bring, I want to be ready, and my faith needs to be ready. Somebody from our church family who came to church here a number of years ago came back recently, and they brought with them a shofar. I don't know if you've ever heard the sound of a shofar, but it's a wild, strange sound, especially if you don't know how to blow one. And I think of what I've been learning about the shofar over the past few weeks, and one of these days in the not-too-distant future, I'm going to bring my shofar to church that I've got. It was given to me by a pastor who had come to church here, and he passed on, and he had this shofar, and he wanted me to have it. So I've been practicing with it, and I'm getting pretty good at it. I don't know if the neighbors are completely mad at me yet, but let me tell you, that thing is loud. But it's not even going to be anything, a minuscule nothing, compared to what's the sound that the angels, when they blow the trumpets when Jesus returns. Man, I'm going to tell you, that's going to be a sound that's going to shake the very earth to its foundations. My faith looks forward to that day that Jesus returns. And I hope to be a part of that great day when the trumpet sounds and those that are here will be taken forever to be with the Lord. What a blessing that would be. I need to return to that expectation. No matter how long you've been a Christian, we need to live with that kind of expectation and that kind of faith that says, yes, this story is more than just the ancient pages of distant history and the forgotten myths and legends of a forgotten time. No, this is the truth of who we are. This is where we are. This is what God has for us. And also, I think, as I think of what it means to return, I think it means for us to return to righteousness. There's so much about the culture around us that is drifting into wickedness and immorality and unrighteousness. We can look around the world and we can look around our country and we can see all the things that are happening. We don't have to go very far from the back door of this church to find just about all of the wickedness this world has to offer. As a matter of fact, for most of us, it's as close as something we carry every day and look at a number of times every day, our cell phones. All the wickedness of the world is now available on a little handheld pocket in your pocket device that brings everything that the world has to offer. And we face it every day. We face all those things and all the things that we struggle with and all the things that we're going through. But God's not just calling us for a return to faith, because even the darkest parts of hell and the demons of hell have believed. That's not the point. The point is how we live and who we are. And God is calling us as a country to return to righteousness. The unrighteousness that's going on is not excused by God. And it brings me back to the prayer that Jesus prayed, as well as the prayer that David prayed. Jesus prayed in the Garden of Gethsemane, "Lord, if it be your will, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, Lord, not my will, but yours be done." A return to righteousness is also talked about when David says in Psalms 23, "Lord, lead me in the paths of righteousness for your name's sake." And I think about Jesus as he prayed in the garden. He wasn't unrighteous. He wasn't returning to righteousness. But he was willing to allow God to be in charge of whatever would happen. His human side of him knew what was going to happen. And said, "Even, Lord, if it's your will that I do this, I'm going to be willing to do it no matter what the cost." And I think of what it means to be a righteous man or a righteous woman in this culture. And what we have to say is, "God, no matter what the cost is, let your will be done." And as David said, "Lead me in paths of righteousness because of who you are, God, and for who you want me to be." Our country has suffered over the centuries from many things that we wish we could undo. As a matter of fact, the very foundation of our country, in many ways, was built on wickedness and unrighteousness. You say, "Oh, Pastor Matt, I've heard you talk so much about how our nation was founded on good principles and all the wonderful things that the founding fathers talked about." And there were some great things that they established and some wonderful ideas that they had. But at the very core and from the very beginning of our country, those same founding fathers owned slaves. Those same founding fathers got their wealth. Where do you think the wealth of Mount Vernon and Monticello came from? Where do you think the richest man in the country at the time was? George Washington. And his wealth was built on his plantation and his slaves. You say, "Well, all those great ideas that they had." Yes, they had wonderful ideas, but there was still unrighteousness. And as I thought about what it means to return and be restored, I came across a story. A story about a family with the last name of Miller. A story about a place in Virginia, not too far from where the founding fathers lived themselves. A story of a very ancient plantation and a family. And I wanted to share that story with you today. And I have a little video clip I'd like to show you.
Sharswood is serving the purpose Fred bought it for in the first place, gathering the Miller family together in celebration.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday. Happy birthday to you.
What do you think Violet and David would think they could see that you own this place?
Yeah, I'm hoping they would be proud of us, and I think they would be. They endured a lot. I mean, yes. I can't even imagine what they went through.
Happy
looking down on us now, they must be smiling at us.
If you could just put the picture of that house that's at the very beginning back up, just and pause it, freeze frame it for just a minute. Can you go back just a bit? There we go. That plantation house right there was built back in the 1800s. It's part of one of the largest plantations in Virginia. That plantation house was actually designed in the 1850s from the original house by a New York architect, for a family named Miller. That family was a white family, and during this time in our country's history, they built this huge plantation on this hill. Years went by, decades, centuries. And just recently, this particular house came up for sale. The family had been driving by it and living next to it in that same community for many years. One of the family members was from California. He was a retired Air Force, and he had a career in engineering. And his sister said, you know, I think we ought to buy this house. He went back and looked at it and said he didn't really like it that much. But it was coming up for auction, so they put a bid on it for just a little bit over the asking price at the auction. And wouldn't you know it, at the auction, his bid was the winning bid. He won the auction, and then he went and looked at the house, and he bought it because he wanted a place for his family to be able to come together. You see, his family was also the Miller family. And as the centuries had rolled by, they'd lost track of who they were. Didn't know much about where their family came from or how they even got the last name Miller. The person they bought it from, the person whose house had owned it, had their family had owned it for almost 100 years. Didn't know there would be any connection of any kind at all. But as they bought this home and began to research the background of this home, they realized that a number of their ancestors had lived and died there. What they didn't realize and what they didn't know when they bought the house as a family is that this plantation house was where their family members who had been brought over to work as slaves in this plantation had lived and died. You see, their last name was Miller because that was the name of the white people who owned the plantation. And after the Civil War, when all the things changed, before the Civil War, their ancestors who lived on that plantation were not even known in the census by their names, but by a number. They weren't even recognized by their names. But after the Civil War, they began to write down their names, and they realized as they looked back into the history and the genealogy that this is where their ancestors had lived and died and given their lives to be a financial blessing to someone else. And as you look at that family, and as you think about what it means to be returned and restored, I thought about the faith that these people had when they came to distant shores to be abused and to be used for someone else's financial benefit. And I thought about what it means for us as a country to have this conversation and talk about this. Because if we're ever going to be returned and if we're ever going to be restored, we have to come to grips with who we are. And we must return to righteousness. You see, this white family, when they lived on this plantation, when they died, they put up big headstones next to the local church. And on the big headstones, the Miller families are named in granite and in writing, who they were, when they lived, when they died, their names. When the Miller family who bought this found out that their ancestors had lived there and died there and been enslaved there, they asked where they would be buried. And the man who sold them the house and was part of the family who'd sold them the house said, oh, I know exactly where they are. And he took them around to the side over in the back behind the slave quarters that were still standing there. And he showed them lines of rocks. No headstones. No markings when they lived, when they died, who they were, what their names were. Just rocks. And in neat rows underneath the trees behind the place where they'd worked and worked so hard for somebody else's benefit, the man who bought this home for his family, that now his family owns, stood there as a living testimony to the endurance and the commitment to what he believed in and what we believe in as a country and who we are today. To be returned and restored. To know who he was and to know that as he lived the path of righteousness and his family got together and they began to sing and they began to sing happy birthday to each other in the same drawing room where the white master lived so many years ago. To think about the memories that had gone through that place of his ancestors living in enslavement behind in a little tiny hut compared to that house on the hill. But how God had brought this family full circle. So now that they owned the very place where they had once been enslaved. Let me tell you, that's what God wants to do with us. He wants to take the brokenness of our lives and he wants to take all the messes we've made and all the things we've done. And he wants to bring restoration out of the very worst of circumstances. He wants to bring us together as a country. He wants to bring us together as a culture. He wants America to be that shining light on the hill because we are that shining light on the hill for so many of the world's population around us. But we can only be that if we return to righteousness, to be the people of God he's called us to be, to live in a world that is not looking at the color of their skin, but the character of who a person is. Oh, if God would just get us together and restore us to himself. But in order for that to happen, we must return. And we must be the people of God he's called us to be. When we return to God, the verse that I'm using as the theme for this entire sermon series comes from Zechariah chapter 9 and verse 12. And if you have your Bibles and want to turn with that to me, those of you watching online, Zechariah 9:12 says these words to us. Return to your fortress, you prisoners of hope. Even now, I announce that I will restore twice as much to you. You see, the Miller family that used to live in that plantation house, the white family, is long gone. But the Miller family that lives there today has been restored and twice as much for what God has seen them through. And we are a part of that. I don't know about you, but I've never thought about being a prisoner as being a good thing. Until I read this word. That I would be in the fortress as a prisoner of hope. And I'm asking you to join me as a prisoner, not just of any hope, but of the hope and confidence we have in a God who loves us, who has told us if we return to him, he'll restore twice as much as we ever had before. What a promise and what a blessing. But the word return is where we have to start. We have to return to our Heavenly Father. And when we do, no matter what part of our Christian life or experience we're on, no matter what section of our journey we're in, there's going to be something that happens within us. There's going to be a revival of our spirit, a revival of our thoughts, a revival of our souls, a revival in our families, a revival in our futures, a revival in our blessings, and God is going to continue to pour that out on us. Henry Blackaby said it this way, revival is when God's people return to God, and God returns to them, and everyone sees the difference. That's what's happening right now in Hope Church. We're having revival. God's pouring out his blessings on us. because we're returning to him. And as we do that, as you do that, as I lead by example, and God brings us together, there's going to be something that everybody around this church and everybody in this community is going to see. And they're going to say, we want that. Now, I don't know if every family is going to be able to experience what the Miller family experienced. I don't know if everybody's going to see the blessing of God like they've seen it. But the interesting thing about this story was how God brought them back and how God restored them. And we're going to get into teaching about what the restoration looks like. But for them, this was the first time they'd gotten together and returned as a family to look at all the generations that had gone from that place and how God had blessed them as they returned. And I don't know how many happy birthdays are going to be sung in your living rooms around a table full of cakes like that. I don't know if all the things that we want to see happen will come to pass right away. It might take some time for your family to be healed. Those of you who've been struggling with relationships in your families, it might take some time for those things to heal. There might be some people here who are suffering loss and grief, and it's not easy. And sometimes those wounds never heal. I'm not saying that the wounds of slavery will ever be healed. I'm not saying that those memories will ever be able to be undone from the logs of our memories as we think about who we are as a country. But what I'm saying is that if we will come together, no matter what color we have, no matter what background we have, no matter where we come from, God's restoration and healing can begin as we return to righteousness, as we return to Him, as we return to faith. Those things can be changed. Families can come together. Families can be healed. Miracles can happen. And we're a part of that miracle right now. Little did Zechariah know that we would be quoting him in Vista, California in 2022. But the same words that he wrote so many years ago are just as true today as they were the day he wrote them. Return to faith. Return to righteousness. Return to God. Return to the fortress as prisoners of hope. And I pray that God will bless you this week as you live your life. I pray that God will restore the things that you may be dealing with. I pray that all these wonderful things will happen to you as you live your life. Your family restored, your relationships restored, your health restored. All these things coming to you right now as you return. And every day when you get up, make that choice, make that decision to be the person God wants you to be, to live a life of blessing, to walk away from all the things that would come against you. And as the scripture says, all the sin that so easily drags us back and besets us, and live in victory and in power and in anointing and in authority and blessing before God. I'm sorry I'm yelling at you. I don't mean to. I'm not a yelling preacher. I'm a pastor. I love you. But I just want you to hear the heart of God as he reaches out to you. And he says, come to me, return. There's a great love story in a movie that was brought out a number of years ago now. And the title of the movie is Return to Me. And there's a great song that came out of that. It talks about what it means to return to somebody that you love. But all the love stories in the world don't hold a candle to the love story that God has with each one of us and the love he has for each one of us and how much he loves each one of us. And as little as I can understand about what it might feel like, as that family gathers around that table and is restored and returned to their rightful place as citizens of this great country, as people have just as much right to stand in that drawing room of that beautiful plantation mansion as anybody else, let me tell you, that's how God looks at us and the love he has for us when we're returned to him. And he sees our heart reaching out to him in faith and in love. Return to God. No matter who you are this morning, deepen your relationship with him. Stand before him. Be in his presence. Listen for what he might say. Feel his heart of love towards you. Stand or sit or kneel or bow or whatever you do, flat on your face before him. Make it right. Make it right with him. Live before him as he's called you to live. For those of you watching online, live before him as he's called you to live. Live in righteousness. Live in faith. Live towards his smile. Return.